Terraria's setting menu has a plethora of settings, allowing you to adjust just about anything. However, there are a few settings you won't be able to find in this menu, and are found exclusively within the config.json file found in your Terraria folder. On Windows, this is found within My Games and Documents, and on Mac, it's found here. I don't know, I don't use Mac. I also recommend that you actually use an editor for .json files like Sublime Text, since it's a lot easier to find this stuff with line numbers. Though do be warned, while 99% of this stuff is benign and actually rather boring in general, screwing with this can cause damage if you somehow screw up hard enough. Good, let's move on now. The first setting we'll find is at the very top, on the 18th line of our config file. UseExperimentalFeatures used to be the way you enabled texture packs and seeds in the 1.3 version of the game, but this has since been deprecated, since 1.4 natively supports these features. So turning this from false to true does a heaping load of nothing. The second and third settings are both unlocks, found on the 17th and 46th lines of our file. The 17th line houses UnlockMusicSwap, which allows you to swap your game music to Otherworldly at the Party Girl, normally unlocked by joining a drunk world. The Otherworldly tracks are basically more fanciful tracks for the cancelled game Terraria Otherworld, and I very often use them in my videos alongside Stardew Valley and Calamity Mod official and unofficial music. In fact, the song playing right now is the Otherworldly Arctic theme. Meanwhile, the 46th line houses Settings Unlock World Evil, which normally allows you to pick your evil biome upon starting up when set to true. The evil picking ability was originally locked behind Wall of Flesh when it introduced in 1.3.2, which would normally set the tag to true. However, in the modern day, turning it to false did literally nothing to me, so perhaps they forgot to integrate it into the new 1.4 world selection screen. Who knows? The fourth setting is on the 33rd line. UseSmartCursorForCommonBlocks is exactly what you think it is. If you're more keen-eyed Terrarian, you may have observed that Smart Cursor won't place certain blocks for you, like dirt and stone, whereas some blocks like platforms and planter boxes work just fine. This is because dirt and stone are defined as common. Turning the setting from false to true does exactly what you think it does. It lets you do that very thing. I don't know if people ever find this convenient, but hey, if you like it this way, consider flipping the switch. If you weren't aware, this is also how it worked before 1.3. Lines 12 and 13 both deal with multiplayer. If you've ever played multiplayer, you may know about the team nameplate, basically this thing that tells you their position. This little setting, Team Nameplate Distance, essentially lets you set how far these things begin to render, with a default of 2000 pixels. At 100% scaling, that would be around 125 blocks away. Multiplayer NPC Smoothing Range basically makes NPC movement smoother in multiplayer by smoothing it out, as we all know how bad the internet can get. By default, it's set to around 300 pixels. Line 50's SettingDontScaleMainMenuUp allows you to bring back the 1.3 main menu scaling, when the menu didn't scale to resolution. What this basically does is make your menu smaller if you're playing on a higher resolution monitor like mine, which has a resolution of 1440p. Most people play on 1080p or higher these days, so I say to leave it alone unless you love your tiny buttons. Line 56's Support 4K also lets you choose 4K resolutions, of course. This one's probably the most obvious of all of them. It's set to true on most devices, but it might be set to false if your video card doesn't support 4K, like many older cards from several years ago. All the way down in line 85, WaterfallDrawLimit is originally said to be the height in pixels that a waterfall can draw. Much like our World Evil unlock, this doesn't seem to do anything, as the waterfall draw height seems to be handled by the game's quality setting. Not sure if this is a remnant of something, but it just seems to not work. Line 86 has DisableIntenseVisualEffects, which does the singular job of turning off the flashing that the game does during thunderstorms. A bit of a small thing, but if you don't like the flashing like me, or you're seizure-prone, consider turning this to true. Lastly, FilterLimit and FilterPriorityThreshold, found on lines 91 and 92 respectively. Filters are those screen effects that show up when you enter a biome or graveyard or whatever, and these basically control the amount that render and the priority of which they render. By default, the priority is set to very low, so all filters will render, but if you set it to something like very high, only the highest priority will render. WorldRollbacksToKeep on line 11 states the amount of backup worlds kept. If you've ever went to your worlds folder and you see a world file ending in .world and a backup file ending in .back or .back2, those are basically backups, so that if your world gets corrupted, you can just remove the file ending and restore your world. With the default of 2, the game keeps 2 world backups by default, even though this value can be edited. On line 19, we have the features that should definitely be added to the control menu, but somehow isn't. KeyFavoriteModifier lets you set the key you favor items with. By default, it's left alt, and 99% of Terraria players like myself use left alt to do it. But if you wanted it to be scroll lock, you know, that one key no one ever uses, all the power to you to edit here. This should be in the actual control menu though, I don't know why it hasn't been added. Line 48's SettingBlockGamepadsEntirely does exactly what you think it does. Terraria can be controlled via both a keyboard or a controller, if you for some reason wanted to use a controller. If you turn it to true, it doesn't mount your controller no matter what. Wow. Line 79's Flash Icon for Events allows you to enable or disable that little notification thing that apps can do in your taskbar. The game will remind you if you get damaged, die, or respawn if you're minimized while playing a server. It'll also ping you when you finish generating a world. By default, all of this is enabled, though you can change it. Throttle when inactive on line 82 basically caps your game at 50 updates per second when the window is inactive. Also, did you know that when minimized, all the lighting turns off? The more you know. CloudSavingDefault on line 87 is one that is actually set to false by default. When enabled, new player and world files will automatically save to the Steam Cloud upon creation or saving. If you play routinely across multiple devices, this might be the setting for you, but as a fan of local files, I'm not into it personally. And I generally recommend against storing modded characters in the Steam Cloud. Lastly, there is a bunch of RGB lighting stuff that I won't go over because I don't own any RGB peripherals. Either way, they do exactly what you think they do, and you really can't miss them since everything line 93 and below is dedicated purely to RGB. I mean, there's more lines dedicated here to RGB than there are for actual configs. That's it for a rather long-winded and boring explanation of it. Hopefully you didn't fall asleep. If you enjoy the content, I recommend a subscription, as only around 7% of you are subscribed. Thank you for watching, and good day, and goodbye.